You're watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. Follow along with projects and footage with a premium download available at borisfx.com. And here we are in the third part of the basics of Roto. We're going to carry on with some more of this shot, this time focusing on the hands. And hands can be very tricky things indeed. Not only do you have like the main bulk of the hand, but you also have the troubles caused by these five fingers. How complicated we get with these hands really depends on how detailed we need to be with our roto. Is it vitally important that we have each of these five fingers as their own perfect separate shapes? Or is it okay that we have one big shape that just describes this whole area? Now, we're kind of lucky with this shot because I don't really want a lot of detail in this hand. I'm fine with it, you know, as it is. I'm also lucky in that the movement that these fingers are making don't change, you know, too drastically the outer silhouette of the shape that we're working on. So we have this finger doing something, you know, moving back and forth, up and down. But the general shape of that hand can still remain rather consistent. So let's use this as a way of looking at some other techniques. I'm going to start with where the hand is looking the most complex. So it's, you know, probably around about halfway in. We do have a bit of motion blur here. This is another question that we have to answer a bit later. Definitely a bit later. I think we're going to be in exercise 10 or 11 when we start to look at that. So I'm going to go around about here, which is frame 16. And let's move our forearm mask into the completed masks group. And just so that I can include everyone who's not using Mocha Pro, I will use the X-Spline tool to do this shape as well. If I was doing this normally, I would probably just use the magnetic spline tool in this particular case. Okay, let's zoom in with the Z and pan around using X. All right, so where do we start here? It's important when we're trying to create a single mask shape out of a complex object that we overlap our shapes. So I'm going to start in underneath the wrist and then bring ourselves up over here. And I'm going to create probably a few more points than I might think is absolutely necessary to account for some of the movement that we're going to get. We're really sort of running up against my previous advice of keeping these shapes as simple as possible. This is a little bit of a special case because the hand itself isn't really going to be doing a whole lot of moving around. This really is probably as complex as we want it to go. So for the individual points, I can just click and drag on the handles just to sharpen those up or just to make those a little bit softer. So we've got a nice area going around here. And I want my starting shape here to be as accurate as possible because obviously this is where we're going to be building the rest of the stuff out from. So I'm happy with where we are here. And before we do anything else, let's give this a name. It is hand. It is on screen right. And it is a mask. There we go. Okay, so do we want to track this? Well, probably not, actually. We've already got a track on the forearm that is probably going to be good enough for what we want to do. So let's check it out. So I can connect my hand right to my forearm right track. Let's zoom to fit again. And I'm just going to test to see if this is going to work. So this is looking actually pretty good. I mean, we're getting most of the movement that we want. The only thing that's happening, obviously, is we are losing the shape a little bit where the hand starts to close up. Not only is this not a problem, this is absolutely expected. Because I've closed Mocha to make a copy of this for people who are following along, I'm just going to come back into my toolbars and go to my advanced toolbar. So we've got everything showing up here. What I'm also going to do is I'm going to come to my viewer and I'm going to come down to stabilize. Now, with this turned on, this is going to stabilize the viewer around that tracking that I've got, so the forearm track. So it means I don't have to chase my hand around as much when I want to see what the small differences are going to be. So I'm going to use Z just to zoom in, X, pan around, and I'm going to move a few frames out until I find the point of most drift, which is going to be here somewhere. And now I can use my transform box to move some of this into place. Remember, start big, work small. So hold down the control or command key on Mac, and then just try and distort this into place. So I'm looking for this area here first. That's looking pretty good. And that's taking in this bit. There we go. Okay, so I'm not going to try to do everything with these big movements, because obviously it's these smaller movements of the fingers that are causing the biggest issues. But I am going to come in and just sort of select smaller areas now, and then individual control points where I can't get those working. Another thing I want to do is I want to do point-to-point matching. So what this means, I want the edges to be consistent. I'm going to look at where these points are sitting on this finger. Move to the keyframe I've already made. Let's start working on those. Just bring those in. So let's select these points here and bring those in. And I'll come over onto this little section here. I'm going to move this one into place. Then I can hold my control or command key down again to just move the rest of that line into, you know, pretty much into place straight away. I'm not going to worry about what's happening in the middle of the hand, because whatever happens in the middle of the hand just really doesn't matter once we cut it all out. So then find the point where it drifts the most, just around about there, and do exactly the same thing. So come in, work big with the distortion, see if, like skewing and distorting that in, see if that makes a big difference. So holding down that control key, then coming in, and let's take all of this here, and I'm going to rotate this in. So how do we rotate? Well, we've seen how we rotate with the transform tool. We just go into the one of the corner points, but not quite the corner, and we get it changing to this here. But this will rotate by default around the center. What if I want things to rotate from around this point? Because this is our good point here. Well, this is where we can start to use some of the other modes that we have in our advanced toolbar. So we have rotate, scale, and transform here. If I press and hold W, you can see I'm going into my rotate tool, my rotate tool. E takes me into the scale tool, and Q takes me into the transform tool. So Q, W, and E, but mainly we're going to be using W and E. So let's see how this works. So if I come into the viewer and I hold down W, this is going to turn me into my rotate tool. Wherever I click is going to be my anchor point tool. And I can move this up and down, and I can rotate around the anchor point. So I can come in here, somewhere around there, hold down W again for rotate, and then sort of just move those into place. Come in here, and probably just transform those last little bits. So working big to small. Don't have to worry about being too accurate here, because we're going to pick up all of these other small bits in later shapes. So something around about there. Let's check to see if that comes in nicely. Almost. Almost. The only thing I'm looking at is the top up here. That's not quite moving exactly into place, point-to-point matching. So I just tidied that up a little bit there. So that's going to be a bit smoother. Now we're still off a little bit, like halfway between, we're still a little bit off, but that's fine because we've got the general movement now is working. So I'll select the ones that are off. I know this is going to be where I want to rotate around. Press and hold W, click drag, click on my new anchor point and then drag that rotation in. Nice. Make any other small little changes I need to. I think that should be good. Go, come to the end here. The more you can do without coming into individual control points, the better. So even if it's just moving a few at a time, finding where multiple points are off, it's going to be a lot better and give you a lot more consistent results. So do the same thing over on the other side, check to see where things are going off. It's around about here. Rotate that into place. Transform that into place. There we go. And I'll do the same thing on the opposite side. So we've got this where the fingers are kind of moving over. Find the last good frame, which is actually probably where our keyframe is already. And then the point of most drift. So we're finding the arcs, thinking like an animator, working big. So holding down the control key just to distort that in. And then bring other control points in as groups as necessary. I think here, because the whole shape of our hand has changed a bit here, I'm going to have to go in and do individual points here. Definitely something I want to avoid as much as possible. Then we can sort of see by scrubbing back and forth, we need to make a few more changes here. And this is often caused because the motion of human beings or animals isn't linear, so it's not always at the same speed. So we can be getting from point A to point B, but it doesn't always do it in exactly the same sort of speed all the way through. So we just have to, you know, have a little bit of patience with this. You can see if I'm adding too many keyframes here, which I'm on the cusp of doing, actually. This is always a very good sort of wake-up call for why you don't want to make complex shapes, because you can be chasing your tail a bit more than you need to. And at the end here, this is where the tracking, I'm going to say, hasn't helped us a huge amount. Let's see what we can get with our little control or command key trick to bring most of that into place. I can even shift select to add or take away from my group. And even though that's a pretty messy transition there, because we kept to our sort of point-to-point matching wherever possible, it's not as messy as it might otherwise be. And depending on your tracking, you're going to have to do more or less work at this point as well. The better the original track, the less work you have to do. Another good reason for working smarter and getting your tracking done right. There we go. And now we're at the end of where our tracking data takes us. So what do we do here? Well, let's follow the animation along. We've got our final keyframe here. Let's take us to the end of our track, which, and then find where the hand is, which is around about here. Then use our W rotate trick to get us most of the way in, and control or command click on the ends there, just to get us pretty much the rest of the way there, fill in those last little gaps, then come to the final frame where we can see the hand, which is there. Do a similar thing. Find the point-to-point matching where we can, and then that should help to rotate us in. Go and then control or command to distort that last little bits in. That's not bad. That's left us in a pretty good situation where we just have to do a final tiny change just to get that other frame in there. Then what do we do on the last one? Yep, that's right. Animate it off screen. There we go. Layer properties. Turn that off there. Let's play it back. Zoom to fit. I like to play it with a stabilizer on first, just to sort of isolate that a little bit. That's fine. And then I'll turn the stabilizer off in the view. Play it back one more time. Hit asterisk on the number key to zoom to fit. Okay, so how can we tell now whether this is starting to look right or not? Turn off my transform box. Going to come into view. Going to come into mats. Going to change my mat view to all mats. And then turn my mats on. There we go. So we can get a nice little overlay just to see if that's starting to come together. And it's looking all right. It's looking so all right. I'm going to move my hand into the completed masks. I'm going to change my shape fill layer in that whole group now to a blue. And let's play that back. And this is heading in the right direction. So in exercise 9, we've actually done quite a lot of different techniques for Roto. We've looked at the basic ideas, obviously, about how we start and what to do even before we start to draw the first shape. And we've also looked at the core ideas of tracking once using multiple times. So we connect multiple shapes to a single tracked object. We've looked at the concept of working big to small. So always start animating using the biggest areas possible, or using the biggest shapes possible, I should say. Then working our way down to groups of control points before doing single control points. Single control points should be the absolute final thing that you do when trying to manipulate shapes. I suggest we take a break now. What I'm going to do in that break is maybe polish up a couple of the frames that I'm missing here, and also do the other hand as well. When we come back in exercise 10, where we continue with the basics of Roto, we're going to be looking at something I call filling in the gaps. And this includes little techniques about what we can do when we can't get good tracking data on a particular shape and how we compensate for that to make our life easier anyway. So if you're going to be following along with me as well, now is a great time to make another cup of tea or coffee and start completing the rotoscoping for your own left hand. But that's it for exercise 9, and I'll see you in exercise 10, where we continue with the basics of Roto.
You've been watching the free version of Mocha Essentials. To download all videos, projects, and footage, purchase the premium version available at borisfx.com.